Hello everyone, I'm Shamsudheen. I'm a PhD student under Dr. Sridhar Sivasubbu and Dr. Vinod Skaria at CSIR IGAB, New Delhi. Today I'm going to talk about genomics for understanding rare genetic disorder as a part of International Rare Genetic Disease Day. I'll start my presentation with an interesting story, the story of Bai. This story happened in way back in 2009. The very next day of announcing the Indian genome, Indian human genome, at early in the morning, Dr. Sridhar received a call from an unknown number by introducing the caller as the Bhai, the Bhai speaking. He was little bit scared, and the guy continued speaking. He spoke about how he came to know the Indian human genome story from a local newspaper, and which also mentioned by doing so, one could identify the disease caused by the genetic mutation. He was curious to know about the disease affected in his family, including himself. But later follow up with his clinician, we found that this family were affected with some genetic disorders. Before going to the story further, we will discuss little about rare genetic disorders. Any disorder, in any inherited disorder which affect less than 100 people per 100,000 individual is considered as rare genetic disorder. If it affect less than 2 individual per 100,000 individual, then it is called as a ultra rare genetic disorder. Rare genetic disorders can be broadly classified into two. The first being due to the variation in nuclear DNA, the other being the variation due to the mitochondrial DNA. The definition of rare genetic disorders differs in different countries. For example, in US, any disease which affects less than 200,000 individuals is considered as a rare disease, whereas in European Union, any disorder which affects less than or equal to 5 per 10,000 individuals. According to the study done by Simonson et al. In 2012, it is estimated that across worldwide, more than 30 to 40 million people are affected with more than 7,000 different rare genetic disorders. But now we know that from Oming, more than 7,800 genetic disorders have been cataloged. When we talk about India, we don't have any clear statistics about the prevalence of rare disorders. But according to a study done by an NGO shows that approximately 64 individuals out of every 1,000 live births carry a rare genetic disorders in India, in urban India. But the actual prevalence is very high in different isolated ethnic group. One of such example is the study done by Ghosh and Rao in 2005 shows 1 out of every 20 child carry a rare genetic disorders in isolated ethnic group in a Bangalore based study. When we consider each disease, for example, the global prevalence of beta thalassemia is 1 in 100,000 individual, but it is in India, it is estimated as very high than 3 to 4%, and even in certain places it is prevalent as high as 5 to 15%. Here you can clearly see from an available statistics, the prevalence of rare diseases are very higher than that that as compared to the global prevalence, which is majorly because of the unique population structure in India formed due to the various conserved and cultural practices. You can see the genetic makeup of various Indian population is heterogeneous. This results the existence of population-specific rare diseases such as Hantigoto syndrome, reported only from certain regions of Bangalore, and the other being Madras motor neuron disease, which only prevalent in Tamil Nadu and that too in an ethnic certain ethnic group. Though rare diseases affect small fraction of the population, it can be cause high economic burdens. For example, one of the study on Marfan syndrome in Europe, they showed that the amount spent to manage the Marfan syndrome individuals is way higher than that of the normal individuals as shown in the graph. In this study, they also shown that if we diagnose the disease at early onset, we can manage the diseased individuals will not develop any further cardiac complications, which will reduce the healthcare expenditure drastically. Due to this reason, large-scale initiatives have started from different organizations, including governmental bodies from different parts of the world. Since only small fraction of the population benefit out of such initiative, apart from governmental bodies, we do not have much commercial enterprises addressing these issues. Unfortunately, in India, we don't have any large-scale initiatives apart from some of the known NGOs. These initiatives actually produced fruitful results. For example, Forge Canada Consortium have studied over 300 cases in last 2 years, and they found genetic lesions for over 100 cases. The research from European Consortium is much more interesting in the sense they have found 12 new disease-causing genes which increase the diagnostic potentials up to 10% among the studied individuals. As I mentioned earlier, in India, we do not have such results since we do not have one. But the ground reality is one out of every Indian have a rare genetic disease. So we have started an initiative called Guardian, which is Genomics for Understanding Rare Diseases India Alliance Network. In this, we visualize to provide the correct diagnosis of rare genetic disorders and convert this knowledge to understand the disease better using model organism. In this program, any individual can submit their samples to Guardian Consortium through their clinicians. And once we collect the sample, by using next generation genomics tools, we try to find the genetic lesions and send back the report to the clinicians. Further, these variations will be used for genetic screening as well as model in zebrafish to understand the disease better, and thus for the step towards understanding and curing rare diseases. For studying rare genetic disorders, next generation genomics tools have been shown to be promising results. One could use either whole genome sequencing, exome sequencing, or candidate gene sequencing for studying the rare genetic disorders. Whole genome sequencing provides the complete variation profiling of an individual, and thus we can find any possible variations. But at present, even though the techniques are advanced, whole genome sequencing is not economically feasible in large. The other method of choice is to go for whole exome sequencing. In this method, one can generate all the variation in protein coding regions. This method can be powerful for the fact that more than 85% of the disease causing variation reported so far in OMIM is in coding regions. Above all, the existence of powerful computational tools to analyze these data and the economical feasibility as compared to the whole genome makes whole exome sequencing is much more friendly tool. If we are studying only limited number of disease and that too in a large sample numbers, the candidate gene sequencing is by using NGS tool is the another approach to study rare genetic diseases. Since at present we do not have much knowledge about the mutation spectrum of various rare diseases from India, we opted for whole exome sequencing for our first method of choice in our program. The next question is, how do we go about doing this? Here is an overview of exome sequencing. First, we isolate the genomic DNA either from blood or saliva, and then randomly fragment using mechanical or enzymatical method. After ligating and adapted to these fragments, we capture all the coding regions containing fragments selectively using specific probes. Then sequence these enriched exome by using NGS platform. Once we have sequenced these regions, we have to screen these read data from low quality and adapters using different computational softwares. Popularly, FastQC and Trimomatic softwares have been used to perform this process. Once we have the high quality data, we have to align these data to reference human genome using aligning tools to find the variations. Various tools are available to do this alignment. For example, MAC, BWA, and Bowtie. If we have high quality data for exome sequence analysis, one can be used BWA since it is really fast and easy handling tool. Once we finish the alignment, the next process is to identify the variation. Traditional pipeline will not consider the PCR artifacts and other biasness properly. So recent pipelines such as GATK offers the method to address these by using duplicate read marking and realignment by using GATK Picard tools. And then the variation can be called by genotype likelihood methods. Once a variation is called, which can be around 25 to 50,000 depending upon the capture size we have used, then we have to prioritize this variation to find the causative variation. The first screening criteria can be used the zygosity based on the inheritance, followed by the non-variant comparison and removal from the public databases such as DBSNP, and then predict the function based on the nonsense, missense, or splicing, or the other variant forms. Then correlate these data with clinically by candidate's gene approach and validate these variation for segregation in other non-affected individual from the same family and find the causative variations. Since the variation can be of different types on different places of the genome, one can be used different bioinformatics tools to predict the functional consequences. SIFT and Polyfin are one of the most extensively used tools to predict the functional effect, where SIFT assign each amino acid substitution a score based on the structural effect on protein, whereas Polyfin assign the score based on the conservation of the amino acid across the organism by hypothesizing functional elements are highly conserved across the organism. After this, once we have prioritized the variations, the next step is to identify these, whether this variation is actually causing the disease or not. For that, we have to go back and screen all these variation in all the family members, with including affected and non-affected members. Here, in this case, that exome sequencing have done and found that number of variation which could be explained by clinical symptoms. And then the next step is to amplify these variation by using PCR, specific PCRs, and screen all these variation in across the people. And by using capillary sequencing, we can find that many variations will be present in both the affected and non-affected individuals. So we can rule out this variation will not be causing the disease. And there will be certain variation which will be present only in the affected individuals and which will not be present in the non-affected individuals. That will be the candidate variations that we can say that that is the causative variation for this specific condition. So coming back to Bhai's story. So we went back and extensively studied about this family through the clinicians, and then we found that multiple family members were affected with blisters and bulges in the skin as shown in this figure. And this family consists of 54 members, with 32 were affected. And by doing the phenotype analysis, we've done a preliminary diagnosis as epidermolysis bullosa simplex with autosomal dominant inheritance. Epidermolysis bullosa simplex is a group of rare inherited skin disorders characterized by skin fragility, which causes blisters and further erosions due to mechanical pressures or frictions. Majorly 7 genes are involved, but 14 were catalogued till date. EB prevalence is varied from 1 in 25,000 to 1 in 50,000 individuals. Prevalence is varied from countries to countries. In India, two studies have been documented, but no genetic characterization have been done so far. At present, more than 524 variations have been recorded which causes EB. More than the EB caused due to multiple genes and which can be caused by number of variations, we opted for the exome sequencing in this family, and then we have done exome sequencing of two individuals from two different generations by using Illumina platforms. And we generated approximately 41 and 32 million reads, and we have done the computational pipeline as I explained in my earlier slides. And then we have found that a mutation in the LINKER12 region of keratin 5 genes, which causes an L325 position mutation to H, which occurs in LINKER12 regions of keratin 5 genes. LINKER12 regions of keratin 5 genes is a binding domain with keratin 14 genes. Keratin 5 and keratin 14 together form the intermediate filament keratin fibers, which act as a shock absorbing matrix between upper epidermis and lower epidermis. Since we have found this variation, the next step is to identify whether this variation actually caused EB or this phenotype in the family or not. For that, we went back to all the available samples, which include both affected and non-affected individuals, and then we have sequenced only these regions and by using capillary sequencing, and then we found that only this keratin, the L325H mutation in keratin 5 gene segregating in all the affected individuals, which was not present in all the unaffected individuals, which proves that this mutation could be the putative mutation which causes EB simplex in this family. By target PCR and capillary sequencing performed in 14 individuals, and we found that this is segregating in all the affected individuals. From this, I conclude that majority of the rare genetic disorders could be identified by genomic based techniques. Exome sequencing can be utilized as a powerful tool to identify genetic lesions, understanding most of the rare genetic disorders. Systematic approaches need to be channelized to address rare genetic disorders in India. Guardian, Genomics for Understanding Rare Disease India Alliance Network, a collaborative network of clinicians and researchers to address the rare genetic disorders in the country. You can get more information from our website guardian.meragenome.com. Any person can submit the sample through their clinicians, either blood or saliva of affected individuals, along with parents, siblings, all available blood relatives and all other clinical details. Then only then they could be enrolled into this study. The study report will be communicated to the clinicians once finalized the results. At present, all the services in Guardian is free of cost, which is funded by CSIR, including sample pickup. Anybody can contact for further details to Dr. Vinod Skaria through his mail ID, vinod@igab.in, or Dr. Sridhar Sivasubbu by sridhar@igab.in. Yeah. I hope you guys enjoy my talk.